Dr. Harris is an associate professor of clinical medicine at UCSF. She earned a BA degree, magna cum laude, in anthropology at Harvard University, and her MD from Stanford University. She is board certified both in internal medicine and hospice and palliative care. Her initial work in palliative medicine was with the Palliative Care Leadership Program at UCSF, where she was a faculty and helping to mentor some of the fellows in that program. In 2009, she transitioned to the UCSF and Trauma Center Hospital as Associate Medical Director of Supportive and Palliative Care Service in order to establish this inpatient palliative care consult service and program. Currently, she serves as chair of the Safety Net Special Interest Group within the American Academy of Hospice and Palliative Care. Her clinical interest and scholarly endeavors focus on the provision of palliative care to underserved and culturally diverse patients in the safety net setting. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Harris.
Thank you so much. I'm really thrilled to be here. It's perhaps as a hazard of working in the safety net setting, unfortunately, I have no financial relationships to disclose. But I'm really thrilled to be here and be able to discuss this really important topic. And I'm really hoping to make this more of an interactive session where we all learn from one another. So hopefully we'll have a lot of fun. So this can actually be, or at least to me, is intimidating. So when you think about cultural differences in medical decision making, what are things that concern you? Anything? Anything else? Absolutely. You might offend patients and families. We hear this often from residents or fellows that I'm working with. You also might worry that the medical care that you're providing might be influenced by your own cultural biases. And how can you help to prevent that? That you may not know how to make patients or families understand, particularly if they're from a different cultural background. That you may lack knowledge about certain cultural issues and that may lead you to suboptimal care. That's something that I think we all fear, actually, right? And then there can also be frustration around different cultures and how that actually influences the care that we can provide and the conversations that we have. And I've heard many times patients, providers being frustrated that that families, they want to keep information from a patient and not allow you to have a conversation. So how do we deal with that? So we're going to have to deal with that even more. As you're all aware, there are significant changes in demographics across our country. And currently, ethnic minorities comprise a third of the U.S. population. In 2010, one out of five adults over 65 was an ethnic minority. And in 2050, ethnic minorities are expected to be the majority. And this is demonstrated, I think, in this really very dynamic change. If you look in the difference in ethnic distribution in the 1950s and over even just a 50-year span of time, how astoundingly that's actually changed in our country. So something we're going to need to deal with more, and something that you actually already are dealing with quite a bit here in San Mateo County. In California, as I think we all know, is one of those states in the United States that's actually quite ethnically diverse. And so even in the county that you're seeing patients in right now, there's quite a diverse ethnic spread. We also recognize that there are significant disparities in care and outcomes for patients who have chronic kidney disease. So this is a great review from Cruz in 2014 that demonstrates from a variety of different studies that ethnic minorities suffer disproportionately from chronic kidney disease and end-stage renal disease. So they patients who are ethnic minorities have three times the incidence of end-stage renal disease than whites. There's significant geographic disparity in chronic kidney disease prevalence that exists and varies by race. Chronic kidney disease progresses more rapidly for ethnic minorities than for whites. And there are such stark socioeconomic disparities in outcomes for dialysis patients that vary by race, place of residence, and treatment facility. So some of this is actually, some of these data have actually already been alluded to in previous talks. But this is a look from the Dartmouth Atlas, and this is a look at really the astounding increase of the number of patients who are receiving dialysis by various forms. So the dark purple line is for patients who are actually receiving hemodialysis. The green line, patients who are receiving peritoneal dialysis, and the purple line, patients who are receiving transplants. So that's actually dramatically increased in recent years. We've also talked a little bit about the Dartmouth Atlas and looking at treatment patterns and how they can vary by region. So this is a look at the percent of Medicare beneficiaries who have end-stage renal disease. The higher proportions are in the darker color red. So you can see how that varies significantly across regions in the United States. But this actually is even more interesting. If you look at, these are the percentage of Medicare patients that actually have end-stage renal disease and have AV fistulas involved in their type of care, and looking how that differs from the distribution of patients who have end-stage renal disease. Quite significant. And then similarly looking at the percentage of end-stage renal patients that receive living donor transplants, again, varies quite significantly by geographic region. Great. So my hopes for the next hour, I hope that I've been able to tease you a bit in terms of recognizing that racial, ethnic, and socioeconomic differences contribute to disparities in treatment for patients with end-stage renal disease. That could be a whole talk unto itself, and we're not going to focus on that. I'm really rather going to focus on looking at culture and defining cultural competency and cultural humility, and help working with you to learn to apply these concepts in conversations with patients and families. And then I'm going to try to be very practical and talk about six common cultural factors that influence decision making, and provide and give you strategies to better address these issues in your conversations, and then give us some time to actually practice that. So cultural competence and cultural humility. So what is culture? So really it's the lens through which we look at everything. It factors into everything. It's an integrated pattern of human behavior that includes language, thoughts, communications, actions, customs, beliefs, and values that varies by a variety of different groups that you may individually belong to. There are a multitude of factors at play. We've been focusing primarily on race, ethnicity, but there are a multitude of other issues that define culture and define us as people. How does culture relate to healthcare? Well, again, it's the underpinning of everything, really. So culture defines how health information is received, how rights and protections are exercised, what's considered to be a health problem, how symptoms are, what we determine to be symptoms, and how you want to pursue a treatment for those problems, and what types of treatments should be provided. What is cultural competence? Cultural competence is defined as a level of knowledge-based skills that are required to provide effective clinical care for patients from a particular ethnic or racial group. Cultural competence really focuses on for providers on obtaining a certain set of knowledge and skills. So as providers, we need to focus on obtaining a knowledge base of factors that can influence cultural beliefs and values and health behaviors of the patients that we're providing care to. And we also have to work in obtaining our skills in communication, both recognizing verbal and nonverbal communication, and really working to use professional interpreters, particularly when we're dealing with patients who speak a language other than English. On the other hand, cultural humility is a term that was actually coined by Melody Turbulon and Jan Marie Garcia, who are two physicians who practice here in the Bay Area. They coined this term back in 1998. And this is rather looking at culture in a longitudinal way, in an attitudinal way. It's really a lifelong commitment to self-evaluation and self-critique, recognizing that as we work with patients, that there's a power in differences and imbalances that exist between providers and patients in clinical relationships, and that we really need to work to endeavor to improve these imbalances. They also introduced the concept of working to advocate at a higher level for the institution in which you're working with and making sure that the institution that you're working for is also on this longitudinal process of self-evaluation and self-critique. So as we've talked about, this is much more attitudinal. There's an awareness that culture shapes values, that you acknowledge that these differences exist among cultures, and that you respect the differences, and that you really start at a different place of accepting patients' worldviews and values as a starting point for the physician-patient relationship. So in terms of comparing these two things, cultural competency, again, is really more about not building your knowledge base and training, whereas cultural humility is really more about introspection and co-learning with patients that you're working with. The strengths of cultural competence is really about skill building as opposed to strengths with cultural humility, which encourages lifelong learning and really this journey with patients as you work to in a mutually beneficial relationship. Shortcomings of the two, cultural competence, there can be this sense that if you learn about a culture, that you can actually have a chance to learn to know everything that there would be about that culture, and that's clearly not something that's true. And there's also a myth that cultures would be monolithic. With cultural humility, really it's more about challenging the idea and learning along with your patient as you work with them. So the analogy that I like to use and the way I think of these working hand in hand together is that is thinking about the analogy of a road, and that there are many components that would go together to build the road. There may be a way that you lay the asphalt itself, the paint that creates the road that might be common, but really each individual patient, they journey along a unique path and really need to be with them in going along that journey and have a desire to be on that process with them, recognizing that you may never reach the end with them as you journey along, but really committing to this as you work with them. So in terms of beginning to practice this humility, we really need to learn and know this about ourselves. And so one of the activities that I will not do here in this session, but would encourage you to do on your own, is to create a personal identity wheel. And this is where you will take and write down all of your identities, your race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, and then allot the size of the pie chart based on how aware you are of each of these different identities, and recognize how that what you bring to the table varies quite a bit and may not be what others appear or what others think of you. We also have to recognize that Western medical culture has its own culture. We have our own language, our own values, our own customs, norms, and hierarchy, and that subspecialties have their own subcultures as well. Within the culture of Western medicine, there are many values that we hold that I'm sorry, hold on a second. And we have to recognize that really it's a continuum as we're talking with patients, and that these values are not necessarily held by all cultures. And really it's the negotiation of that of those differences that's really important. So working and shifting gears now to look at some common factors that impact medical decision making. I'm going to try to list these in order, and these are in order of which I actually look at these as I'm attempting to have conversations with patients. And of course, communication and bridging language barriers is paramount. And so really it's not about whether a patient speaks a language other than English as the primary language, It's really important to understand their health literacy and recognizing that our medical language is a foreign language unto itself. The risks and consequences of not approaching this or not paying attention to this is bi-directional misunderstanding. Patients may receive unnecessary or undesired treatment, as well as unnecessary physical, emotional, or spiritual suffering. Strategies that you can use include using professional interpreters. There's a wonderful session that Ann Kinderman's going to be giving later on, so I'm not going to talk about this in great detail, but it's really important to avoid the use of family or bystander medical staff for interpretation. Also, as you're talking with patients, you want to avoid complex medical jargon. You want to check in frequently to assess understanding and seek advice from cultural insiders, which may include the interpreter within that conversation or a colleague that may be of a similar ethnic background. Explanatory models for disease causation. I think it's important to recognize that there are multiple different types of models, and it's important to ascertain these of patients at the beginning any sort of conversation. So I'll go through many of the different models for disease causation. One includes natural etiologies. I think this is a etiology that we're more comfortable with in a Western medical perspective. Whether behavioral or risk, behavioral risk factors are contributing to disease causation. Whether supernatural factors are causing or contributing to disease, and whether it's social etiologies that are contributing to disease. Consequences for not attending to this may be that you would have fundamental misalignment regarding the reason for disease. Also, potential ramifications if their is their personal responsibility seen as playing a role in affecting the disease. So explanatory models and techniques that you can employ. I start every meeting by gauging a patient and their loved one's perceptions of their explanatory model and what the disease process is and what is actually going on. So we'll go on to the third topic. So family involvement in medical decision making. Remember that Western biomedical framework, we value patient autonomy, the right for patients to be informed of their condition or treatment options, the ability to choose or refuse life prolonging medical care, and actually ask patients to write this in medical advance directives or impulse form. And to recognize that for many cultures, medical decision making is really the duty of the family. The responsibility to protect a dying patient, or to remove and to remove the burden of decision making from the patient. The third entity that I wanted to talk about was our family involvement and consequences is that you may alienate a patient and family if you don't attend to this issue. So strategies here, again, to talk with the patient to determine the desired level of involvement in receiving information and decision making, and to ascertain key members of, that they would like to be a part of any sort of conversation. The fourth entity is truth telling, and again, remembering that this is a Western biomedical framework, and it's only recent. In the 1970s, this was not something that that was considered. And the pendulum is clearly swung to value patient autonomy, informed consent, and the discussion of prognosis with patients. And recognizing, again, this is not the norm for most of the world. Many countries, from Southeastern Europe all the way to the Middle East, the physicians, patients, and families feel withholding medical information is more ethical and humane. Consequences for not attending to this is that patients can have develop anger and mistrust and remove themselves from ongoing medical care, where there can be blame for contributing or causing to the worsening of the situation or introducing hopelessness and misunderstanding as to why the patient is being informed. So strategies here is to use the strategy of informed refusal if you feel that you actually need to talk with a patient about an issue. And that is to do something like, for some patients, they want to know everything about their condition, and others prefer that doctors talk with their families. Would you like to receive information, or do you prefer that I speak with your family? Another strategy would be to use a hypothetical case. So many patients are in a similar condition to yours, have found it helpful to consider treatment options such as, and this acknowledges patients' fears, it respects the need for indirect discussion, and implicitly invites additional questions from the patient and from the family. The fifth is our response to inequities in care. So recognize that several groups have historical pasts, mistreatment, abuse of medical research, and ongoing current inequities in all other realms of life. And current studies reveal physicians' perception of patients are influenced by patient ethnicity, and patients and families know this. So consequences, again, to not attending to this could be lack of trust, an increased desire for futile or aggressive interventions, the lack of ability to collaborate with patients and families, and dissatisfaction with care for all involved. Strategies that you can use and employ here, so you can explicitly reference to work towards achieving the best care possible and helping to eliminate those inequities. You can also address it directly. So I wonder whether it's hard for you to trust a physician who's not in your same background. You can also work to understand and accommodate desires for aggressive care, but respectfully negotiate in instances of medical futility. And finally, religion and spirituality. So again, a Western biomedical framework that we often discount the importance of religion and spirituality. Many believe that God has ultimate say in end-of-life issues and death, and not the physician. And that oftentimes suffering may be redemptive and should actually be something that should be in the work. The consequences, again, for not attending to this could be potentially a lack of faith in a physician or medical treatments, a lack of adherence to treatment regimens. And strategies, again, to help address this would be assessing the importance of spirituality and religion in your patient's life. So where do you find strength to make sense of this experience? Our spiritual or religious strength sustains many people in times of distress. What's important for us to know about faith or spiritual issues for you? And you should also work to leverage chaplains when you can. So I'd like to just talk about one study which I feel summarizes many of the entities that we've talked about. And this was a study in 2010, which looked at factors that influence surrogate decision makers' perceptions of prognosis. So this was a prospective mixed methods, semi-structured interviews with decision makers of critically ill patients. This was performed at one setting at UCSF. And surrogates were interviewed between days 3 and 5 of a patient's mechanical ventilation during their hospital stay. And they were asked to determine what they thought was the patient's prognosis, and then also describe factors that they felt they utilized to determine what they thought their loved one's prognosis was. And this I found to be very humbling, again, sort of along that journey of looking at yourself. Less than 2% of the surrogates felt their belief about prognosis relied exclusively on prognostic information that was provided by the physicians. Other important factors that were identified and oftentimes were more important than prognostic information provided by the physician was the surrogate's belief in the patient's intrinsic qualities and will to live. Their interpretations of the patient's physical appearance, their knowledge of the patient's history of prior illness and poor survival, and the power of bedside presence of family and community, as well as issues such as optimism, intuition, and faith-based beliefs that playing significant roles in their determination of prognostication. Any questions at all at this point? So what I thought we would do now is actually begin to practice some of these skills. So I've got a role play that we can do. If we can pair off into groups of three, then we can begin to work on this. And I'll hand out the different roles.
The situation is an 88-year-old Tagalog-speaking woman who's brought to the hospital by her children. She has progressive renal failure for several years, and in prior conversations about her renal disease with her nephrologist, have been leaning towards not pursuing dialysis as her renal failure has worsened. Her family has noticed her decline over the past several months, and given some recent confusion and seeing her spend more time in bed brought her to the hospital for further evaluation and disturbed dialysis. So one person in this triad is going to be a clinician or a physician or a nurse. The other is going to be the patient, and the other will be the daughter. So as the attending nephrologist on service, you enter her hospital room and find her with her eldest daughter. And the patient's regular nephrologist is out of town and not available. So we'll hand out the
So what were some of the skills that you may have employed, or any sort of important take-home points, or how did people feel about this encounter?
You know what? I was the patient, and I felt left out because, my voice is pretty, but anyway, I felt left out because at first she was only looking at my daughter. And so I felt she wasn't looking at me. And she was talking for me, she was talking for me, and I guess she didn't read my thing. I cheated and showed her that. You know, maybe some of my concerns were gonna be addressed because, you know, you could keep talking to the family member and not, you know, getting the patient's perspective. And number three, you know, before you use a family, should you not ask, we can get you a professional interpreter, because that's your right. It's a patient right to have it in their language. So would you want a professional, you know, an interpreter, or would you want your family to be?
So you can ask a family or a patient whether you would want to have a family member act as an interpreter. I would say standard practice would actually be to use a professional interpreter. And there can be real dangers in using a family member as an interpreter. But I think it's also a balance in terms of alienating a patient if they absolutely want to have their family member interpret. So you have to sort of delicately walk that balance. And I would also say that it's really always very important to obtain an interpreter if you have any question about a level of proficiency of English. So for example, if the daughter speaks English and they say, oh, no, I'll just interpret because I can speak English, it's really actually very important in order to get all the information across to the patient that you actually have an important interpreter. And so usually what we'll say is, you know, for topics like this, it's really very important for us to have an interpreter who's trained in medical terminology to help with this conversation. And the other thing is that it's really hard for you to actually be her daughter and work as an interpreter at the same time. So I want to relieve that burden from you and allow you to be the daughter in this conversation. So can we have a professional interpreter? So those are some of the examples of some of the ways I would approach that.
I will say, though, her comment about being included may be a reflection of Western culture versus Filipino culture. And I just want to make sure, or Jewish culture, or whatever culture. And so we have to consider, as we're role-playing, that we really don't know. And in my experience, an 88-year-old lady, and I don't mean this disparagingly, is more subservient to the younger family members in that culture.
Thank you. Okay,
did someone here have their hand up? Just a quick add-on to the strategy on how you try to offer having interpretive service. My daughter, well, the daughter in our role play, she actually was a nurse, and so, you know, I'd love to take it that next level. So how do you kind of navigate that? You do have someone in the medical profession that, you know, thinks they have it.
Particularly when the daughter wanted to also be, did not want an interpreter. And despite my asking, and I was the patient asking.
Oh, and how do you negotiate that? So the patient actually asked for an interpreter, and the daughter said,
and the daughter was nervous, said, no, I'm fine, I can speak both Tagalog and English, and I want dialysis for my mom starting tomorrow.
Very tough.
Right, so it was. Vanessa and I work with a lot of Tagalog in the nursing home where we work in, and what we've actually found is they do make reference to the elders and calling them, you know, aunts when they work with them, even though they may not be aunts. Mm-hmm. And they defer judgment frequently to elderly people within the workforce or within the family.
I have a question in the back.
Here you are.
It's actually a comment in our scenario. Neha did a good job of, I was supposed to be the daughter of a non-English speaking mother. And as I said, I'm the oldest daughter and I'm going to be the one deciding. She said, yes, your input is very important, but I also want to hear from mom. And so she kept always making the eye contact with the patient. And I know even just as far as cultural humility, when you do that and you're kind of empowering through that type of an interaction and body language, you know, I think that speaks across all cultures. And the other thing was that in my practice, actually, I rarely ever give that option of having a family member as an interpreter or using a professional interpreter, because I find it to be best practice that you get a professional, and I don't even offer the family member as an interpreter because I normalize the fact that the family's there to be a family member of support, and when you're busy interpreting, you might miss something or forget to ask me something, and I would rather everything be answered or you have a fair chance in this discussion as participant. And so I always say, well, we always practice that we have an interpreter so we can have the most of this conversation. And so that's how I'll do it.
Marvel. Terrific.
So what do you think about what she just said?
I agree with that. I think it dovetails with what I had responded, that typically all normalize this by, really, it's important for you to be acting as the daughter and be able to process the information. And if you're trying to act as an interpreter, you simply really can't do that. And so it's our standard to actually have a professional interpreter, particularly if a patient is actually asking for it, then I would really advocate for the patient. There are occasions if a family is going to become adamant about, no, I really want to interpret, I will double check with the patient about whether that feels appropriate. And if they say, no, I really want them to interpret too, then at the risk of completely sort of throwing the baby out with the bathwater and losing your therapeutic allegiance and alliance with the patient and family, proceed, but then work to try to have a professional interpreter on subsequent interactions if you can.
Can you define in this instance what you mean by a professional interpreter? I'm assuming that you're talking about your employer who has that list of, 300 people available to do that, right, in the hospital setting.
Right.
And so I say that versus an outpatient setting where the only way, the usual way that's done is by a telephone. Mm-hmm. At a rate of $300 an hour. Trust me, I've checked out some of these, and some of them are less expensive, but you don't know who that person is, you don't know what their background is. You know, it's a service, but in healthcare, the language can get very strange, and even internally, if they don't know the specialty, they're lost.
Right.
So we're actually mandated by law to provide interpretive services for patients who speak an English or a language other than English. And professional interpreters have received additional training. Our time is up here, but additional training about how to interpret appropriately. And we're actually, if you attend Dr. Kinderman's session later this afternoon, you'll actually recognize all the other different layers and different roles that interpreters play in supporting your communication, your conversations. It's not just literally interpreting from one language to another. I think there's also, you can run the risk of misinterpretation if you use staff who just happen to be like bilingual. They've not necessarily received appropriate training in medical language, and I think that this is certainly a huge risk. And then there are a multitude of risks that would come from using a family member as an interpreter, which we can go into because we're running out of time. But great. Thanks so much.